This episode of Witchpolice Radio is my interview with Bryan Sveinson of UMFM 101.5's The Pity Party. Bryan, along with a lot of other people at UMFM, like Michael Elves, Jared McKidiak, David Dobbs, and others, have put together a really awesome project. It's a punk rock Christmas album made up entirely of local bands. The album, which comes out December 5th, will be available online with all proceeds going to the Winnipeg Humane Society. We talk about the project, we talk about some of the other great things going on at UMFM, we talk about Bryan's own show, The Pity Party, and a lot more. Plus, you get to hear four tracks from the album before it comes out. I also wanted to give a huge shout out to everyone who voted for Witchpolice Radio in the Uniter's annual poll. This marks the third consecutive year that the show's been selected as Winnipeg's favorite podcast or radio show. And it's really, really awesome to see that people like the show enough to listen to it, let alone actually give us a vote in a poll like that. So thanks again. It really means a lot. Not just in terms of, you know, having bragging rights over other podcasts or whatever. It means a lot because more ears to this show also means more ears on all the bands I'm interviewing. So it's kind of a win-win for everyone. And I also want to give a big shout out to Papercut Podcast, who are doing a great job with interviews with all kinds of interesting local people in the art scene. And they finished second in the voting for favorite podcast. I actually thought they were going to win. I was expecting when I opened up the Uniter website that I would see their name on top. But they finished second, and they got an article written about them, which you should read. Definitely encourage you to check out that show. It's really good. And yeah, thanks again. It's pretty cool to get recognized. Hopefully I'll just keep doing the show at the same level of quality I've been doing, and people will continue listening. This episode of the podcast is brought to you by our friends at the Park Theater. Please visit myparktheater.com to check out all the great shows they have coming up. Thanks to everyone who's supported the show so far. Thanks to supporters like you, we can keep churning out interviews twice a week. If you like the show, please head down to patreon.com/witchpolice, and for as little as a dollar a month, which is less than 12 cents an episode, you can help keep the lights on.
You're listening to Garbage Hill, Winnipeg's first podcast network.
Welcome to Witchpolice Radio. I'm once again in a car, which is really seems to be the new place that I do these days. But I kind of like the sound we get out of a car. I mean, you, I guess, are used to a more professional studio type setting. But, yeah. You know, here we are. And this is kind of a last minute episode we're getting in before the release of something really cool that UMFM is doing.
I really appreciate it.
Yeah, I'm happy to talk about it. When I first heard about the project, I thought it was a great idea. And before we get too far into that, though, do you want to just introduce yourself and what your role is with UMFM and where people might have heard you before?
Sure. My name's Bryan. I'm on the board of directors at UMFM. That's a new thing.
Okay.
I got elected at the last AGM that we had in September. Before that, I've been with the station for about 2.5 years as a volunteer.
Yeah.
I do my show, The Pity Party. It's been bounced around to a whole bunch of different slots, but currently it's Fridays at 1 o'clock. In the afternoon.
And you're mostly focusing on, like, emo punk kind of stuff, yeah?
Yeah, stuff like Midwest emo stuff, you know, everything from, like, very, very, very early Weezer to Sunny Day Real Estate to more modern stuff like Remo Drive and The World is a Beautiful Place.
I didn't actually realize Midwestern emo was a thing until I was interviewing Nice Cops.
Yes.
And they mentioned that as an influence.
Yeah.
And it makes sense, but I've never really thought of that as being a separate genre within the larger emo kind of umbrella. But yeah, it totally makes sense. And those bands you mentioned too, it fits a sound, right?
Yeah, it's just like it's sad punk played a little bit slower, right? Like it is, and heavily influenced by like indie stuff as well, right?
Sure.
Like a lot more melodic and you know, obviously the original emo was like the Rites of Spring, Mind Threat, DC hardcore scene. But yeah, it's really evolved over time and it is more, it's less about like the way the music sounds and more about like the emotional expression and the DIY culture that's kind of surrounding it.
Sure. And that's sort of ties into what we're doing here because UMFM is putting out a punk rock Christmas album.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. About a year ago, I decided that I was just pouring through Christmas songs because I'm a big Christmas dork. I love playing all the music and stuff like that. And I was trying to put together my show and I realized that like I just did, there was such a lack of Canadian punk and emo Christmas music, especially local, which is, you know, tough when you're when at the station.
You have the mandate, right, to play local, yeah.
Yeah, you are trying to support as much Canadian and local content as we possibly can. And so I was, this was in about, you know, late November, and I said to myself, I'm like, well, I kind of want to make a Christmas album, but obviously it's too close to Christmas right now.
Yeah, that's pretty short turnaround time, yeah.
Yeah, so I want to say in June, I started floating the idea by Jared McKediak, station manager, and Michael Elves, our program director, and they're like, hey, this is something I want to do. And Jared's like, well, get some bands on board, start organizing it yourself, and you know, we'll give you all the resources that you need. And about mid-July, I sent the text out to about 8 different bands, and I was like, hey, this is the plan. This is what I want to do. I want to record over these months. I've got a studio space. I've got an audio engineer who's on board with it.
Yeah.
And let's go. You know, if you want to do a cover, great. If you want to do something original, even better.
Oh, cool.
And so I just started like whittling stuff down, and you know, bands jumped in and out of the project. Even the leftists, who are super awesome, super local, they jumped into the project like a week and a half ago.
Oh, wow.
Just recorded on Monday. And their song is great. They wrote an original, Coop wrote it in about 10 minutes apparently.
Oh, wow.
He's a legend.
Yeah, definitely.
And it is, no joke, the most Manitoban Christmas song I think I've ever heard in my entire life.
Okay,
it's beautiful. But yeah, so we just, you know, through September and October, you know, he was organizing the bands, which can almost only affectionately be referred to as like herding cats.
Yeah.
It was kind of a pain in the rear end at times.
Well, how many bands are actually on the finished
11.
Product? 11. Okay.
11, yeah. It was originally 8, but then some dropped out, and like more bands heard about it from, you know, contact
or whatever, they were
like, hey, what's this project, and can we get in on it, and you know, and I got recommendations from some people as well, like, hey, if we're doing this, you should get this band.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, there's 11 bands on the finished product, and they're all wonderful. Every single song that we've recorded is awesome. Every band came in, they were tight, they were ready to go, they were well organized, so that was really nice.
Cool.
And, yeah, David Dobbs is an absolute magician.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Well, I mean, he's kind of a standby at the station at this point, where he does all those live sessions and everything, so yeah.
Yeah, he's wonderful.
How did you pick the bands? Was it just bands that you personally liked, or did you kind of have an idea in mind of, these guys could pull off a good Christmas song? Like, was there any of that?
It started out as just bands that I had connections with, right? Yeah. Like, you know, where it was going to be easily approachable, like, hey, like, I know you guys, some of the bands are just really close friends of mine.
Sure.
But as the project went along and some of them dropped out and I started to try to add other bands, it was like, no, like I want to add bands that are going to put together like a really good Christmas song. Yeah.
Was there anyone you wanted to get but you couldn't? Like, was, did you?
Yeah, there was a couple bands that didn't fall that didn't come through. Bleed American.
Okay.
I contacted them and they were all aboard at first. They were like, yep, no, this is great, blah, blah, blah. And then in about October, they were like, you know, this isn't going to happen.
Yeah.
Which is a shame because I really liked their music and I thought they would have been able to put on a really good Christmas tune.
It was always next year, I guess, right?
Yeah, exactly, right. And Nick Dyson was the other one.
Oh, that would have been cool, yeah.
Yeah, I contacted him and he was on board with it. And then about 3 weeks ago, he sent me a text. He's like, I've tried up 4 or 5 songs. I just can't get an arrangement that I like. So, you know, keep me in mind for future projects, and I'm really sorry. Super nice guy.
Awesome guy. Yeah, yeah. Great music too.
Yeah.
Who is on the album? If you can remember offhand.
Okay, we're gonna try and remember this off. Screaming at Traffic.
Yeah.
Parkview, The Uglies, The Brotherhood and Co., Sawyer, Look North, Ceilings.
Okay.
The Murder Birds, Alone I Walk. The Leftists, and Rossa McTiernan from Lake Disappointment.
Cool. It's a pretty good lineup.
Yeah.
So how did the Sawyer thing happen? Because he lives in Alberta now, right?
Yeah. You know, it's kind of funny that, like, he recorded his song well before anybody else.
Okay.
I sent a message to Boys Club.
Yeah. The late, great Boys Club. Yeah.
Yeah, the late, great Boys Club. Yeah. And I was like, hey, like, I know you guys aren't making music anymore, but if you guys wanted to come in and bang out, like, one last goodbye track for this Christmas album, that'd be awesome. And they were saying, you know, we're going to talk about it and blah, blah, blah. And then they got back to me and were like, no, like, we're not super into it. But then Zach messaged me on the side. He's like, I'm actually really into
this. Cool, cool.
And so he's like, I don't know how we're going to make this work, but I could send you a bunch of stuff, or like when I come in for Thanksgiving,
yeah,
we can just bang the track out. And so we did. He came in early on on the Saturday before Thanksgiving, and we spent about 5.5 hours
wow.
tracking, and it sounds great. He did. He covered Half Man, Half Biscuits. It's cliche to be cynical at Christmas.
Okay. Okay.
And he did a really great job of it, and it was really funny that like I was struggling to get like Winnipeg bands to give me a time when they were going to get in, and here's this dude from Alberta that's like, let's go, and
just
comes in, gets the track done, and it was ready months before anybody else's.
That's kind of how I got him on the podcast too, because he'd already moved by that point, and he just said, I'm coming in for Christmas. This was last year.
Yeah.
Can I be on the show? We made it work. So
it's really weird. Like he, you know, obviously like I interviewed him as well about a month and a half ago for my show.
Yeah.
And we were talking about it that, like, you know, even though he's in Edmonton and playing all these Edmonton shows at these really cool Edmonton venues, like the Sewing Factory or whatever the heck, he really is still just a Winnipeg entity.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. So what is the release plan of this? I mean, is it going to be physically released or just digital, or what are you doing with it?
Well, I mean, like, because of copyright problems, we can't actually...
Oh, the cover songs. Yeah, yeah,
we can't actually press CDs, but we have figured a little tiny way around that. Of course, the easiest way to get the album is on Bandcamp.
Sure.
It's up for pre-orders as of right now, and you can check out Ross's track. He covered Fairy Tale of New York by the Pogues.
Oh, cool.
He did an amazing job of it, too. So you can get that track and pre-order the album, but it comes out officially on December the 5th.
Okay.
When you'll be able to pick up all 11 songs plus all the bonus material, the liner notes that we did, about 27 photos of bands in the studio.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah.
Yeah. Just having a good time and whatever. But if you're a fan of physical media, we are doing a kind of a half measure. You're not actually going to get like a disc, but we are printing Christmas cards.
Oh, cool.
With the album art on the front, the track listing on the back,
yeah,
a little thank you note, and a download
code. That's a great idea. Definitely fits the subject matter of the album. Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. So if you want one of those, you can contact UMFM or any of the people that were involved in the project, and we will get you a Christmas card.
That's very cool.
Yeah.
Is this something that... I mean, once this is out and once people have heard it and everything, is this something that you're hoping to do more of at the station? Like, more kind of themed? Because it's a great idea.
Yes. It's been bounced around that for next year we want to kind of do a Halloween one.
Oh, cool.
But, you know, it was a large headache and a stressor at times to get everything ready and going. And I guess, like, everything that's a labor of love, kind of you have to put in that kind of effort.
Sure, sure.
So whether or not it's this coming year or the year following, David Dobbs and I and Jared and I have talked that we do want to do more compilations, and not just punk ones either. Like, I mean, that's my bailiwick, right? That's my leisure domain.
Yeah, totally.
We want to get other creators involved and be like, hey, like, you know, if we want to put together like a folk one,
or,
you know, if we want to put together like a metal one, because I know the city's got a pretty decent metal
scene. It does, yeah.
You know, if we want to go through the Invisible Man or whatever and round up all the Winnipeg ska bands and do like a ska one or whatever.
I can help with that.
Exactly, right?
Yeah.
You know, like, we think that it's A, really good for the station. B, you know, like, we can connect with a whole bunch of charities on it as well.
Yeah, totally, yeah. Especially Christmas, right? It's a good, yeah, yeah. Do you think that maybe the facilities at UMFM for doing these live sessions are maybe not that well known outside of the station? Oh, I think there's a lot going on there that I even forget about, and you know I'm there every once in a while, but like it's there's so much stuff there that people can take advantage of, like exactly. Bands especially.
Yeah, you know, and that's something we told, and bands were just blown away. They were like, when we were recording them, we're like, we had no idea that you had this here.
Yeah.
You know, and David would tell them our you know our price structure for private recording, but. You know, for bands, we do live sessions every single week.
All the time, yeah.
All the time. And it's basically just like a concert, right? You come in, you play a gig.
Yeah.
Dobbs records it, mixes it a little bit, and throws it out on our website and to all the creators who might use it.
Yeah.
And so basically you get like a nice little demo. It's not, you know, like...
Well, it's live still, but yeah, it's
live. But it's a nice little demo that you get, and it's just like having a gig, and it's mm-hmm. free. It doesn't cost you anything
and
if you're a band.
You're on that list with all these great bands that have done it over the years too, and yeah. You can see your name on there and your songs and stuff. Yeah,
exactly. We did put a little more effort than just live in for the CD.
Okay, yeah, it's a different project. Yeah.
Exactly. There's a lot of tracking involved. We did the instrumentals live off the floor, but we did overdub a lot. And
okay.
We overdubbed the vocals as well.
Okay. So yeah. I know we're here talking about the Christmas album, but yep. Just about the recording and stuff at UMFM, what happens if someone's hearing this and says, oh, I didn't know they had that? Like, how can someone get involved and go record something there?
The easiest way is to get a hold of David Dobbs,
okay.
Which is Dobbs, D-O-B-B-S, at UMFM.com. Of course, there you can check out our website. There's at UMFM.com. There are ways to contact us through there. We wouldn't even mind if like one of you just swung by the station on the third floor of University Center
yeah.
in between degrees and the hub, and just went and talked to Jared and Mike. I'm like, hey, you know, we're a band, we're local, we want to do a live session, and
yeah.
you know, it's immediate, it's right there, and we love having local bands.
Yeah, oh for sure, yeah. It seems like that's almost. I think people just don't know. They just don't know what to do, right? I mean, I know a lot of people in bands, they're thinking, how can I get my music out there? And there's this great resource
yeah.
right there. I mean, I'm CKW as well. I mean, Winnipeg has all these small stations that really want to get local bands heard, right?
So. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And, you know, I can't say enough about local bands. They're wonderful, right? You know, so use our resources as much as humanly possible.
Yeah.
Use CKUW's resources. You know, get talk to you about
yeah, exactly. Yeah, there's so many options out there, and like, I think people just need to know about them.
Yeah.
I mean, with my own show as well, there's a lot of people who are just hearing about it for the first time, and I've been doing it for 6 years now, right?
Exactly.
I mean, it's just awareness, I guess, that there are people who want to talk about your band and want to hear it and want to record it and stuff. And
yeah, I mean, like, I don't know, like everyone seems to have this worldview, right? That like if you're not instantly famous,
yeah.
it's a problem
or it's a failure or something, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But like, there is something to be said about being part of a really great local scene, right?
Yep.
You know, like I go to these punk shows and these emo shows and I see the same 30 odd people, and it's a community, and it's awesome, and it's so much fun to be a part of.
And they're
of
all in each other's bands too.
Yeah, exactly. It's such an incestuous.
It is, yeah. It's unbelievably incestuous, yeah.
Yeah. Like Sean Kay is in like
yeah.
eight bands.
I think I've had him on for about five of them on the podcast, and it's ridiculous. Like he's always there. He just shows up every time.
Yeah, exactly. I think I can only name like five of them off the top of
yeah.
my head. Hot Sewer, Elder Abuse, Nice Cop, Ceilings.
Witch Trip.
That's it. Witch Trip.
And there's probably more that we're not even thinking of,
yeah,
I'm sure. Yeah,
exactly.
At this point. Yeah, yeah. But yeah, no, it's I think the cool thing about the local music scene too is that, you know, despite the incestuousness, every band will have one new guy.
Yes.
Or one new girl. And then they end up being part of this circle
yeah,
of people
exactly.
who are forming new bands, and each time you add one new person, and it just kind of
drawing more people
yeah.
in, drawing more friends
yeah.
in, exactly, et cetera, et cetera. It's great. It's such a, you know, and it's welcoming, and
yeah.
it's open, and it's, you know, it's inclusive, right?
For sure. Do you think that this, because of the subject matter with the Christmas songs, do you think this has the opportunity to appeal to more than just that immediate punk scene?
I mean, I hope so,
yeah.
right? That's the hope, right? We're doing this for charity. I'm trying to give a nice big check to the Humane Society
mm-hmm.
At the beginning of January. So I'm hoping that that's the case, right? I mean, not all the songs are like, they don't necessarily all sound super punk or emo.
Okay.
I'm going to show you one after this. The one that's up for pre-order is Ross's Fairytale in New York. And like he does it acoustically.
Cool.
Right? So like if you're into acoustic music, it is a very it's a very folk track.
But
I mean,
that's basically
it's
a punk folk song,
right.
folk punk anyway, right? I mean it's
right.
it's got so much attitude to it and
exactly.
edge to it, yeah.
Yeah, we've got three acoustic songs on the record. There's that one. There's Sawyer's and Alone I Walk involves like a ukulele.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah, big fan of the uke. Big fan of the uke.
Yeah. No, that's neat. That's good. I'm looking forward to hearing it. I mean, it's a cool idea. Why did you choose the Humane Society as the benefactor?
I personally myself, I'm a huge fan of dogs and cats.
Yeah.
And like, it's just a big thing in the scene itself, right? Like,
it is. Yeah, there's been punk shows in support of animal shelters and stuff, like a lot actually. Yeah.
Yeah, like Brendan McLean's another UMFM mm-hmm. Volunteer and awesome dude in a bunch of incestuous bands again.
Yeah.
He had a show a while back to help his cat Charles Mingus.
Yeah, that's right. I saw the ads for that. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Great name for a cat, by the way.
Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah. Have you seen the cat?
I haven't seen the cat.
He's this big, fluffy, white cat that just like looks like the grumpy all the time.
Okay.
He just looks angry, and it's so funny. But he's just a nice cat. But yeah, like we, like a whole bunch of punk stuff for, I guess it's just like a punk and emo thing that we just all love animals.
Yeah,
so
which is funny because you got this aggressive music and then this like soft underbelly where they're like, oh, the kitties.
Yeah, right? Like, I just want to be kissed by a dog.
Yeah,
all the time.
Totally. Yeah, no, I get it. I get a dog and a cat. I totally understand.
Yeah.
No, that's cool. I'm glad there's a cause too. Right? I mean, especially with the holidays and everything, it makes sense that not only are you spending all this time and effort to record this, but there's a goal at the end of it as well.
Yeah, exactly.
People can find it on Bandcamp.
Yep.
it's the best place.
Yeah, umfm.bandcamp.com.
Okay.
It's up for pre-order right now, so you can lay down your $5 or however much you'd like to donate.
Right.
You get Ross's track immediately, and then when it goes live, you'll get emailed a download code saying, "Hey, this album is out."
Cool.
You take the download code, you click on the link, you enter the download code, you get all 11 songs.
Nice.
And every single awesome bonus feature that we're adding in.
All the photos and all of that.
All the photos, yeah. The liner notes, the alternate artwork that we've got.
Cool.
The track listing artwork that we have. Yeah.
I don't know if we talked about this, but what's the name of the album?
Nothing Under the Tree.
Nothing Under the Tree. I like that. Yeah.
Yeah, it's great. Jared and I were bouncing ideas back and forth. I was at the doctor's office, I don't know, about 2 months ago. And I was so bored because I was waiting. I ended up waiting at this doctor's office, this walk-in, for like 2.5 hours to see a doctor. And I was just bouncing ideas back and forth with him. And I just started sending like really stupid ideas for names. Sad Snow, Enter the Christmas, 36 Trees.
That's pretty good.
Burnt Lights. Lance Snow, record holder Clark W. Griswold Jr.
Okay.
From Under the Pine Tree. Not Your Average Christmas Album. Hungover Holidays. And Jared's like, "No, those all suck." And then like half a second later, he was like, "Nothing Under the Tree." And I'm like, "That's it.
That is good.
That's the name."
That's awesome. And so the bands, I'm assuming, are all they're all promoting this too. Like, they're gonna hopefully be sharing.
I mean, that's
it
the hope. Yeah. Right. That's the hope.
In case anyone forgets what the album is called, like, hopefully you follow one of those bands on social media and you can.
Yeah, exactly. I sent it all out to them this morning before coming over and doing this with you, and I was like, "Hey, you guys are all getting a free download code and a Christmas card, but the pre-order's out now, so if you could promote that,
yeah,
that'd be
yeah.
super
yeah.
kind of thing, right?" So,
is there a way, obviously there is a way, but what's the best way for someone to get in touch with UMFM if they have questions about this project, or if they, you know, if they've forgotten the link and they want to know how to get it?
Yeah, I mean, like, all of our social media is really, really easy.
At UMFM for the most part, yeah.
Yeah, it's really easy and accessible. I think the Instagram is at UMFM115.
Yeah, that's right, yeah, yeah.
But all the rest of them are, you know, UMFM. Jared is very responsive on the Facebook.
Absolutely, yeah, yeah.
So yeah, if you just like get a hold of us on Facebook at UMFM, that's fine. If you want to get a hold of me personally, mm-hmm. do that as well. My Twitter is at Svenish, SvennyIsH.
That's your Instagram as well.
Yes, that's my Instagram. Or you can get at me, Bryan Sveinson, on Facebook, and I'll be more than happy to help.
And what is the, just because you're here, you might as well plug your own show.
Sure.
How can people hear that?
I'm on the Pity Party. It's, yeah, of course, Fridays at 1 on UMFM. That's 101.5 on your FM dial, or you can listen live online at umfm.com, or if you get our app, you can get that.
Oh, that's right,
well.
The app, yeah. We should have mentioned that earlier.
Yeah,
right.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
We've got an app. You can listen to that. There's all my archive broadcasts for the last 8 months. So if you just want to listen, and like I'm usually pretty good at doing my show log, so like you can see the playlist.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Be like, "Hey, this is what he played this week. I'm into that song, so like let's take a listen."
Yeah.
When I curate my shows, I always try and keep like every single block is like a similar feel. So like if you like one particular track in a block, you'll probably like the rest
of it. Yeah, it's not gonna be a drastic jump to something else, right?
No,
yeah, yeah.
No. I mean, like, it is a pretty themed show. It is all within the same vein and genre. So,
yeah, yeah, yeah. Do you feel like there's enough of an emo scene in Winnipeg? I feel like there's a lot of punk bands that kind of have emo leanings, but is there really an emo scene here?
There's like three bands or four bands. Fox Lake
okay,
is
yeah.
like absolutely, but they only play like one show a year. Alone I Walk is absolutely an emo band,
right.
But again, like there's only the two of them, the Corsellis brothers, and so they can't exactly play shows unless they bring in their touring musicians.
Okay.
And I don't think I've seen them play here in a long time.
Boys Club was absolutely, yeah,
absolutely,
yeah.
But RIP.
Yeah.
So no, it's just mostly like punk bands with like emo leanings.
Yeah.
Well,
I guess bands like Nice Cops would fit into that kind of category as well.
They're a punk band with emo leanings.
Yeah.
But I don't necessarily think that's like a problem, right? There is a subgenre of emo that I think a lot of these bands fall into called sparkle punk.
Okay, I've never heard that before.
Yeah, yeah. It's bands like Sorority Noise and Modern Baseball and stuff like that.
They actually have come up a lot on this show when I'm talking to punk bands. Modern Baseball seems to be a lot of like, you know, guys in their mid-20s are really into that band. So
they're not a thing anymore, unfortunately,
okay.
But they are awesome. And yeah, that's exactly it, right? Like bands like Pop you know, to
Yeah, totally.
To name like a Canadian band. Yeah. Like those bands like that, they fall into the subgenre of, and like it's a
sub-sub-sub-genre.
Sub-sub-sub-genre of both punk and emo called, Sparkle Punk.
Okay.
Or I guess some people call it party emo because they don't like the word sparkle punk, but whatever.
Sparkle punk is great. I like that term.
Sparkle punk. Yeah, so I would name like every single band in that sort of scene, I think, falls under like sparkle punk.
Okay.
I think sitcom is probably the closest thing we've got to like
emo
right now.
Okay, cool. Well, yeah, emo bands. If you're starting an emo band, you should hit up this guy.
Seriously.
I mean, the pity party seems like the best place to get exposure, right? I mean, if you're playing that style of music.
Yep. I have bands on, like, as much as humanly possible. If you just email me and we're like, hey, like, we're a local Winnipeg band. We play this type of music. We want to get on. I'll be like, yeah, okay, cool. Like, when are you available in the next 2 weeks?
So. Awesome. Great. I mean, and that's the best thing about campus radio in general, is that, like, most shows are really, like, not desperate, but really want to. If you have a band, they want to hear you. You want to hear them on your show.
Yep.
Everyone else's show, the same thing. It's like the point is to promote what's going on in the city. So.
Exactly. Yeah, we're campus and community. I would not be able to do this show on a commercial station. So
yeah.
Bless UMFM.
To hear more episodes of Witchpolice Radio, you can go to witchpolice.com. All 330 whatever episodes are there for download and streaming.
Cow.
Yeah, it's getting ridiculous. And you can also hear this show on UMFM on Sundays at midnight.
Yep.
And those are older episodes that kind of get a second wind. So it's usually a few months after it was recorded and originally released.
That's usually where I listen to them. I got Mondays off, so I'm up late on Sundays.
Oh yeah, right on. So yeah, I mean, it's maybe not the prime time for radio listening, but there's no reason why it couldn't be. I mean, midnight
exactly.
Sundays, you're driving in the car, turn it on, there's a podcast.
Exactly. So. It's the best of its kind in the city. So.
Thank you. Awesome. Well, yeah, thanks again. I'm looking forward to hearing the Christmas album.
Awesome. Thanks so much, Sam.
Right on.
It was Christmas Eve, babe. In the drunk tank, An old man said to me, I won't see another one. And then he sang a song, the rare old mountain dew. I turned my face away and I dreamed about you. God on the lucky ones came in at 18 to 1. I've got a feeling this year's for me and you. So happy Christmas. Oh, I love you, baby. There's gonna be good times when all our dreams come true. They got cars big as bars, they got rivers of gold, but the wind blows right through, it's the place for the old. When I first took your hand on the cold Christmas Eve, oh, I told you that Broadway was waiting for me. You were handsome and pretty, queen of New York City. When the band finished playing, the crowd howled for more. Sinatra was singing and the drunks, they were swinging. Sherry kissed on the corner and danced round the night. And the boys from the NYPD choir were singing Galway Bay. And the bells were ringing out for Christmas Day. You're a bum, you're a punk, you're an old hurling junk, laying there almost dead, in the drip in the bed. You scumbag, you maggot, you cheap, lousy blackguard, happy Christmas, me arse, I would rather be dead. And the boys from the NYPD choir were singing Galway Bay, and the bells were ringing out for Christmas Day. I could have been someone, and so could anyone. I took your dreams from you when I first found you, but I kept them with me, babe, and I put them with my own. Can't make it all alone, I've built my dreams around you. And the boys from the NYPD choir were singing Galway Bay, and the bells were ringing out for Christmas Day. Oh, I love you, baby. There's gonna be good times when all our dreams come true.
Ha ha.